pleasure and privilege it is to be here today to speak at such an important event in the North East Labour Movement calendar. I think it is a bit unfortunate though that I have to stand opposite my comrades Ian Lavery and Graham Morris, who provide for quite an intimidating audience. I'll try and do my best, Ian and Graham. The miners have always known their history, haven't they? And in Durham, we know the central place that mining history has in the country. Not just as the economic fabric of life, but because of the cultural richness that the miners' unions brought to the country and region. I think it's also appropriate to say a couple of words about Davy Hotbank. His passing has left such a big hole in the North East political and trade union life. It's occasions like this today that Davy lived for, honouring the past but looking forward to the future with hope and passion. He was fearless and committed, touched the lives of thousands, and we all miss him and we miss his counsel and instincts. We are here today to pay tribute to a history which lives with us today. Thomas Hepburn was born in 1795. He was first sent down the mine at the age of 8. I mean, imagine that, 8 years old, not playing, not being lost in making dens or hide and seek, but childhood, a construct not afforded to our class. He was at the coalface. He became the leader of the first mining union, Northumberland and Durham Pitmen's Union, formed in 1825. Because of this, he is seen as one of the, and quite rightly, one of the founding figures of the mining trade unionism in Britain. Through strike action, Thomas Hepburn's union was able to reduce the working day from 18 hours to 12. As many of you have guessed, I've not been down a mine before, apart from at Beamish, but my gender and, you know, Thatcher made sure that that was never an option for my generation. But I cannot imagine an 18-hour day in any job. The bosses thinking that it was somehow reasonable for men to only have 6 hours to wash the thick coal dust from their faces and from under their nails, a difficult job, I'm told. Then to eat and sleep and socialise and see family all in 6 hours, that those workers deserve no social time whatsoever, their lives just reduced to profit-making machines. It must have been utterly grueling. In 1832, he led a hard and bitter but successful solidarity strike over union members being given employment, where miners were unfortunately shot by police. Shortly after, the union was broken by the coal owners and the leaders were victimised. No shock there. Thomas Hepburn never worked in the mine again and ended up being forced to sell tea at the mine just to survive. He was only able to regain employment by promising not to take part in union activities, a compromise I am sure laid heavy on his soul. He died in 1864 after having dedicated his life to the education of miners and to achieving shorter hours of work for mine workers. He remained an active Chartist all his life. He was a political trade unionist who understood the context of industrial struggle in the politics of his time. Comrades and friends, you know that every single gain that we have made as a class, every pay rise, every holiday, every weekend, maternity and paternity leave, every break in the working day, every ounce of decency afforded to working people has been struggled for. It has never been gifted by the state or by employers. And many of those gains that were won through strike action, as Thomas Hepburn's story tells us. And at every point, these rights are under attack. Just this morning, I met with trade union reps and conveners of a factory in my constituency, their rights being ripped up, causing them extreme hardship. So the battle of yesterday is still the battle of today, because as a movement, we cannot take a breath, because we have learned from common history that if we rest, if we cease to fight, our rights and freedoms are eroded by a capitalist class who are organised and very, very ruthless. And we need to, today, carry on and renew that struggle constantly, bringing new workers into the movement and organising ourselves into a strong, united workforce. What became known as new unionism did exactly that in the 1880s, organising precarious workers such as the match girls, the dockers, the gas workers who were previously unorganised. bringing women in massive numbers into the union movement and becoming more political in their outlook. And how relevant is that to our current situation with Uber, Deliveroo, social care provision, even being precarious, casualised and privatised? It was trade unionists looking outside of their ranks into communities, much like the Durham Miners Association have done throughout their history, to organise, unorganise and challenge big capital. At our best, this is what modern trade unionism is about. Think about those McDonald's strikers, workers who are so brave in taking on one of the largest corporations in the world, or the cleaners organisation in London and all over the world, the teaching assistants in County Durham, and the work that Unite Community does in bringing together unemployed workers and community activists. What we must fight for now, as well as all these struggles, is the very future of trade unionism. At a time when young people are unaware of their existence and worth, this is crucial. If you ask a young person a day what a closed shop is, they might look at you a bit confused and be like, well, you know, it's a shop that's not open. Like, what are you talking about? Many people under 40 will not have been brought up in homes where trade unionism is the norm, and deprived education about the solidarity and power of trade unions through their education. Many people will never have heard a conversation about trade unions, crucially, in the workplace. So we have a massive struggle on our hands to make sure young people understand the relevance and importance of trade union representation, of solidarity, and the community represented by the magnificent Durham Miners Gala. And by the way, is there any more beautiful a sound than a brass band at events like this or in our communities? They bring, you know, so much warmth and so much joy to my life, certainly. Because being in an unorganised workplace shapes your consciousness, what you expect your working day to be like. Much of my time as a rep and agitator was having conversations with fellow colleagues, convincing them that yes, you do deserve that break, or you can go on holiday, and you can go to the doctors or the dentists, and that work should allow that, and you shouldn't be penalised for that. We must also make sure that trade unions are relevant and live up to the challenges of the modern workplace, of automation, home working, of self-employment. And this does mean organising differently, doesn't it? More flexibly, and using technology now at our disposal to bring together people in the face of atomised and individualised workplaces that Thatcher could have only dreamt of. It is another struggle, but not one that we should look with as defeatists. Because if the election of Jeremy Corbyn has taught us anything, and then the subsequent general election, is that we can be completely optimistic about the future. It has shown us the capacity for consciousness raising and organising online, and that if we speak to people's needs as a movement, then it unlocks a swell of energy, hope and optimism. During the general election campaign, 27 million people viewed a post directly from Jeremy Corbyn's Facebook page. And without losing the touch, you know, the human touch of conversation and dialogue, it is clear that that is a game changer, isn't it? Something that the Conservative Party have no hope in hell of emulating. And I saw for the first time in a long time our movement, and how good is this, usurp the potency of the right-wing media, with young people and adults choosing their own content, bypassing a pernicious content that is chosen for them. And I think, you know, this is an interesting thing to think about, but if we imagine Facebook Live or mobile phones with their current technology, if they had existed in the same way as at the Battle of Orkney, a show of state violence against striking miners, which resulted in concerted and organised cover-up by the state, I'm not sure it could happen in the same way. I'm not saying that it couldn't happen, but it couldn't happen in the same way. When working class people have the ability to elevate our story into the mainstream for ourselves, we can expose our truth. And so I'll end on this. Friends, I have so much hope for the future. I think the movement is awake, it is active, and it is getting very organised. And I think we are on the brink of something incredible. People are more politically conscious and more angry, and quite rightly, and participating. The Labour Party is now the largest left-wing movement or party across Europe, and our manifesto is a symbol of our socialism. Now that energy needs to be channeled into the trade union movement, as it has been in the political arena around Alan Corbyn. The Labour Party is nothing without the trade union movement, never has been and never will be. It is another struggle, but the establishment certainly won't like it. But when we think of the likes of Tommy Hepburn, we should be inspired to think what can be achieved by organisation and graft. We have everything to win, and we owe it to all of those people suffering the indignity of this system. Our strength and hope cannot be defeated. Thank you very much.